All right, we're back again, and our next talk will be by Shamala, and the title is The Road Not Taken. We're very happy to have her here, so there's your digital stage. There you go.
Thank you so much for introducing me, and thank you so much for the opportunity to share my experiences. So I went with the poem, The Road Not Taken. So it goes like this. Basically, it's like two roads diverged in a yellow wood. And sorry, I could not travel both and be one traveler long. I stood and looked down as far as I could and to where it bent in the undergrowth. So it's basically like a poem by an American poet, Robert Frost, and it goes like this. So we are often confronted with and defined by choices we make, right? So we are often also confronted with this fork in the road, and we always have to make a choice. And today in this talk, I would like to take you on the path I took. So I'm Shamala. I'm a software engineer here in Volkswagen Digital Lab Berlin. I've been a software programmer since like a decade now. I think more than a decade. So that's basically about me. And I moved to Wolfsburg in Germany from India in September of 2014. So this is basically my very first overseas country that I visited apart from India. So I was applying for a lot of jobs in and around like Lower Saxony, but I always got rejected saying that I do not have enough German knowledge. So there were times where I frantically Googled if Java code is written in German. For example, like is for loop called für, or if is called when, like what am I missing? Like, you know, I can write code if I understood the requirement. So it kind of like took me almost a year to find myself a job in Berlin. So in 2015, like I got the job here in the digital lab, and for first 6 months I was traveling with ICE from Wolfsburg to Berlin. I used to like wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning, catch then the 6:20 train, come here, go back. And because like almost a year passed by between my move there to, you know, Berlin and travel and everything, and especially to trying to understand the work culture here and all of the new things that I was learning, I was like super excited. And I would like, you know, I didn't even feel that it was really hard that I have to wake up at four, because like I enjoyed my work, I enjoyed my new colleagues, I enjoyed the atmosphere. And then suddenly one day I realized like, okay, I just looked around and where did all the women engineers go? Because my last job at like Bangalore, I was working for a startup where like my team was made up of more women than men. And it was always been like that for me in two other companies that I have worked with, or like it was more like an equal representation at that level. So I realized like, okay, so I mean, it's Germany. It cannot be true, right? Like there are so less women developers, because sometimes I just have a feeling like it would be nice to pair with someone, you know, who thinks like you, who, you know, feels like you, something like that. I was always missing a little bit on that. And then I started like asking around, like, why is it like that? You know, why aren't there in like, you know, a lot of women, people who identify themselves as women as developers. And then in 2017, one day, a fellow engineer from Pivotal Lab, she asked me, hey, why would you like to join a meetup? I know I'm talking in this meetup. This was the first time I even hear the word meetup, but she was like, hey, I'm talking here. And I said, yeah, why not? And what are you talking about? She said she is talking about like, you know, the flex and everything to do with CSS. And I'm a backend developer. So I was like, yeah, I'm super excited. I'm stoked. Let's do this. And it was just an impromptu thing. And I said yes. And that changed things for me. And that's when I made the choice and I said yes. So that was my first meetup. It was a women who code meetup, and I vividly remember everything. It was organized in Get Your Guide office, and yeah, it was really like amazing, and I was so happy to see like so many engineers like in there, like, you know, to share our experiences and you know to get some perspectives and so on. So this was like really nice. And since I heard the word like meetup for the first time, I also discovered meetup.com. And I remember like 11 o'clock that day at night, I just become a member of lot of meetup groups, which I found really interesting. And then like RSVP'd for some interesting talks in upcoming meetups. And then I attended a second meetup. It was a meetup by CodePubble in a very small group of people. But the meetup was about like, you know, writing small applications for Alexa, something like this. I still remember like, you know, someone from the meetup asked Alexa to play a Bollywood song. Yeah, it was really kind of like fun. And suddenly I just realized, like, I went to the organizers and I said, like, hey, what do you think if I came and gave a talk, in your next meetup? So they remembered and they contacted me, like, hey, we are hosting an event in April and would you like to give your first talk? And believe me, that was like the first time I went and talked in front of people since my bachelor thesis. That was like in 8 years, that was my first talk that I was basically giving. And I was super nervous and everything, but the environment made me very nice, and they didn't care if I was stuttering or I was like feeling like, you know, blacked out or didn't figure out what should I say next, you know. But it was nice to kind of like, you know, talk in front of people. And once I gave my talk, I then just went ahead and said like, hey, you know, why don't you come and host your next meetup in the lab? At that point in time, there were like no concept, there were not meetups or anything that was kind of like hosted in the lab. And I had no clue if I even should say that, you know, you can come and host your next meetup. And then I also said, hey, we can also give a workshop on test-driven development. You know, I don't know who would give the workshop. I didn't have the experience to give, you know, such a workshop or something like that. But I just said it anyway. And then I went to my lab director and asked, hey, would you mind if, like, you know, this meetup was hosted in the lab? And he was like, why not? Like, yeah, we can also sponsor some pizzas and everything. And then I went to another fellow engineer who was from another company. And I asked her, like, hey, would you like to just, do a small workshop with test-driven development? And she said, yes. So I was like, okay, so sometimes it's just okay to take a leap of faith while you're trying to do kind of like the right thing, right? So at the end of the year, I reached out to the organizers of Women Who Code to present the same talk, the first talk I presented in CodePub. And this, I did not expect that it would be, because it was end of the year, it was really a huge meetup where I was talking the same thing in front of like 80 people or something like that. It's much bigger network, but whatever network I got from it was from that meetup, and this network and the people and the friends that I have made have stayed with me, and they are part of my journey till date, big time. So I just wanted to touch base, like, you know, if you are looking for a safe space for women and, you know, diverse folks, you know, there are so many. I just listed something that, you know, that came to the top of my mind, like Women Tech Makers, Women Who Code, Women Who Go, Pi Ladies, Code Curious, Frauenloop, GDG Berlin, CodaBee, like all of these provide like really safe space for like, you know, underrepresented folks, you know, to handhold and, you know, to get inspired and to give back to the community. So since then, I have like attended like 30 plus meetups, conferences. I have volunteered or hosted 15 plus meetups, and basically I have also like talked in a couple of meetups and conference and all of these things. So enough about me, and why should we basically do this, right? So it's very important that you are going to build a local network. So you are in this place, an amazing place like Berlin. It's really, really important to build a local network, because it is so empowering when you get help from the network and point the network to someone who can benefit from it. So if somebody is asking me a question about data science, I know exactly where to point them to, and I'm very, very well aware that they will get all the help that is needed from the community. And giving back to the community is the biggest thing for me, because all these communities are responsible for making tech a better place, to think about inclusion, to think about diversity, to be nice to each other, to provide a safe space, to kind of like, help everybody. So this is really, really important for me. And by providing a space, volunteering and sharing your experiences and attending meetups are really, really like, small steps in the direction of giving back to the community. And of course, you cannot hide the fact that it is also giving you organic publicity for the company. Like if you're working for a good workplace where this fosters a diverse culture, where people empower each other, like encourage each other to grow, then you need like more cultural addition to such a workplace. So if you are part like attending meetups or hosting meetups, volunteering for meetups, if you're out there, your personal experience will also bring more credibility than any job description or a marketing campaign could bring. So, and also like it's a great place to meet like potential future colleagues of yours, and it's a really nice safe space for you to get to know each other, talk about the opportunities, what it entitles, what it does not entitle, and so on, which normally you are not getting out of LinkedIn or applying for jobs through some job portal elsewhere. So I want to share a small success story. Two women engineers who are with us actually applied after like women tech makers meetup and top women in tech conference and so on. And we also saw a lot of improvement in our pipeline. Like most of the CVs, particularly from people who identified themselves as women, came through these kind of like events and conferences and so on. So this is kind of going in the right direction, but not at the scale that one would expect it, right? So this is why 2020 is the year of forming like a diversity and inclusion team, because there is a long way to go, and diversity and inclusion is a responsibility of everyone. It is a value to be carried out as a team. Most importantly, have allies in your team. Right? So bringing more women into the team is not that one woman's job, right? You have to make everyone participate. So where do you start? So recently a friend of mine and also a good colleague, he introduced this global diversity and inclusion benchmark from the Center of Global Inclusion, basically. So they have like these nice benchmark. They're like 14, 15 plus categories, which are like kind of classified into three main categories: the foundation, the internal, and the external. So these benchmark will help you to kind of like narrow your focus, or to see which are the things that you have to basically address to. So a foundation is basically you need to have a vision and structure and a leadership buy-in. This will bring more transparency and accountability. So which means like, why do we do this? What kind of initiatives needs to be done? And also like, if you're doing something, like how do we be accountable to it? And internal categories represent the harmony and order within an organization, like how inclusive you are, how are you retaining the employees, how your workforce is like happy. And the external categories project the passion and outlook of an organization, predominantly by what kind of products you are developing and so on. So all of these things are kind of like connected through assessment, communication, and sustainability. So you have to have, like, through assessment, it's the only way that you get like constant feedback. And communication is basically to always be aligned towards the common goal, you know, the vision and strategy that you have set in. And the sustainability is basically a long-term process for pursuing social equity, environmental health, economic prosperity, and ethical behavior, basically. So these benchmark helps you to kind of like show you the path on like where you would like to go. And in each of these categories, you can basically assess yourself on which level you are. The level one is basically like inactive, where you don't have anything, you know, you want to do something for diversity and inclusion, but you don't know, you know, any organizational goals, or, you know, no work has begun. So you start with writing like, you know, a status quo, what it looks like. Reactive is more like if you have an organizational goal, then, you know, are you just like, you know, complying to it? Something like that. And the level three would be like more on the proactive side. So where, you know, you have a very clear awareness of the value that diversity and inclusion is going to bring in, and you start to implement diversity and inclusion systemically. And the fourth step is to be progressive, that, you know, you have showed improved results and outcome that you have set yourself, like, you know, in terms of the vision and the strategy that you already had. And the fifth is like the best practice. You become exemplary role model. So all of this, what I'm talking about is like, if you, in from an organizational perspective, these things help you to channelize, like, on focus on initiatives, like have more than, like, you know, if you take hiring, if you take, you know, retention, every category in itself needs, like, you know, a lot of initiative and focus, and these benchmarks and these levels, how you assess yourself will basically, like, you know, help you to focus on the right things. So at the end, I just wanted to say, like, what diversity and inclusion to me personally is to basically believe that diverse team creates a better world and greatly improve organizational, you know, performance. And to mentor, it's basically to show the way for others, and to empower, to give confidence to others. And last but not least, I cannot stress enough, to also sponsor. So to advocate for others' success when you are in a position. So if you know some, you know, like, you know, you as a team has done a great job, but, you know, saying something about the junior who has, like, you know, given the 200% for the job, and, you know, encouraging them, sponsoring them, and taking them to the next level. And to me, this is what diversity and inclusion means. So at the end, I took the one that is less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. Thank you so much.